Yo, what's up, good people? On this episode of DOD45, my man ArtByTai speaks with the homie Eligh from the Living Legends crew. So listen to ArtByTai, ask some questions to Eligh, and then when you're done, maybe you could go to your favorite streaming service and maybe check out my new album called Scribble Face. So, yeah, AWOL 1, Scribble Face. That's what it is. Or you could go to speakerface.store. But yo, it's time for the magnificent DOD45.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please have your attention? Stop what you're doing and listen.
DOD45.
This is the DOD45 show, drawing over discussions 45 minutes with a special guest. Welcome. I'm your host and resident artist, Ty of ArtByTai, and with my co-host, Adrienne Taiwali'i, we're having conversations with people who I admire and am inspired by. On this episode, I'll set a 45-minute timer, put my pen to the paper, and we'll learn about our guest through an interview-style discussion. So stay right here with us to experience some laughs and maybe even learn a thing or two. Welcome, 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 welcome. Hello, Adrienne. How are you? That's your favorite when I do that, huh?
I'm great. I'm so happy. No, I really am.
Oh, good.
It's February. Oh, we're out of January. I'm so glad.
You have a birthday coming
Goodbye,
up.
Goodbye, January.
And you have a birthday coming up.
Yeah, that's not really the reason I'm excited for February, but yes, that too. Crocuses. That's what makes me happy.
What is it?
Crocuses. Like usually the first flowers in February.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, is that some sort of sophisticated word? I don't know.
Yes.
Is it a flower?
It's a flower.
Oh, okay. Well, that last episode with Skate Laborious was awesome. You know, the sound was a little difficult to deal with, but that's not why I was bringing it up. I love Skate Laborious, and I'm going to continue to do whatever I can to turn people on to it to get them the money that they need to get that place finished, because it's really fantastic.
Yes, one of the things that was making me think all week about like how much I loved grip taping skateboards and putting them together when I worked at the skate shop. It was just so, I don't know, I just loved it. I just love everything about skateboarding.
Me too.
Except for the fact that I can't.
I still can, fortunately. Little nephew is, or not you little, he's grown up. But
he's a man.
He's a man now, but he's pretty good now.
He is good.
Yeah, it's impressive. I follow him on his TikToks. I'm rarely on there, but I do go on there every once in a while and see him doing some pretty cool tricks. So hopefully we'll have to have him out to Hannibal and take him over to Skate Laborious. I keep making mental notes to not do It's my transition, though. So I don't know how to eliminate it, but I'm going to attempt to. So, a couple announcements, unless you have something you want to say right away. It's a quick announcement. We're thrilled and happy to be partnering with Strange Famous Records. That's pretty fantastic, especially being that I'm a huge, I have been a big Sage Francis fan and Strange Famous fan for many, 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 many years, 20 plus years. So, it's really cool that we've hooked up with them. So that what that means is kind of like a sponsorship of the show, but we will now have a new segment in our show with Sage Francis. We haven't figured out exactly what we're going to title it. As of right now, we're going to call it Sage Francis's Social Media Lurk. So we have a question. He's got a video question in for Eligh, who is our guest today.
Oh, okay, for Eligh.
Yeah, that's our guest today. And, you know, it's a little pocket in our show that we're setting aside for Strange Famous Records. So I'm really excited about that. Everyone on their roster is fantastic, and they've all been super supportive of our show. And, you know, so that's that.
Cargo pocket.
Cargo pockets?
Front pocket. Back pocket.
What are you talking about?
You just said pocket, and then I started thinking about
pocket. I said pocket? When did I say pocket?
A pocket in our show. Strange Famous.
Oh, yeah. They're in a little pocket of our show.
I don't know. I just, in my head, just went to cargo pocket.
And also, we've got, you know, of course, the Mr. Dibbs' question from Mr. Dibbs. Unfortunately, he was up all night last night putting together some sort of something, so he didn't get his question in on time, but that's okay. I was going to share that Mr. Dibbs is down 25 pounds last time I talked to him the other night. He's lost like 25 pounds, but I was just going to make this announcement because he'll never make any announcements, but...
Maybe he didn't want that announced.
Well, not that announcement. Maybe he didn't. I don't know. We were just having a conversation about it.
Congratulations, I guess.
I think he's lost like 25 pounds.
He might have worms.
Well, he's been going to the gym a lot and stuff. But I'm sorry. But in my messaging with him today, he was mentioning that he didn't have time to get his question in because they were up all night. But I sent him a little GIF, GIF,
yes,
of Mikey eating the Life cereal. And I said, power up. And he messaged me back and said he has started the life diet. He's been on it for 2 days. So
is that a thing? Power up?
You know, I was just saying power up, like, because he was said he was up all night, so he was tired. And I was saying power up with some Life cereal. And him and I, since the episode where I mentioned I lost 30 pounds eating nothing but Life cereal for a year, he kind of got excited from that and wanted to try it. So
So gross.
I know. And then
I don't know why I do not like listening to people eat cereal.
Oh, it cereal's so
bothers
great.
Me so
Life
much.
Cereal's so good. Well, don't listen to them. I always get it when I'm eating cereal. I have a problem with cereal and soup, but it always drips down into my beard. I don't know why. It's like I can't keep the stuff in the spoon. Somebody had left a comment on one of the YouTube videos. And they said, yo, what's up with your pinky?
So, wait, it's not like that always. You do
look at
that.
No, look at that.
Yeah, but push it back into place.
That's how it is. So it was just funny that someone said that because it does look at it. It's crazy. Anyway.
Making it worse. Do you want me to push it?
Here, no.
Give it to me. I'll push
it
back.
Well, what happened was it was a volleyball accident.
I
was going to do a dig and.
I was there.
Yeah. Well, I had you pop it back into place.
Well,
it
never, apparently, I was being real soft with you.
It never quite worked.
I'll get it right next time.
But on that, when I've noticed when I'm doing my push-ups, when I'm doing my workout, you know how you use your thumb to hold balance? Like, you know, when you're, like, doing push-ups, you have your hands up like that, and you're holding your balance. I noticed that my pinky seems to, like, pop out even more to give me more balance on my left hand, and I'm a little wobbly on my right hand.
You know what you should do? You should ask your doctor if you can get a donor pinky and get like an extra one, like a double.
So that I don't want to
look, because see how it kind of goes out. You could get a double one.
You could have a double. So crazy, yeah.
A double pinky.
If I really wanted to, I could put it down here, but I'm worried that I didn't getting stuck there.
You'd be saying like peace all the time with your pinky.
In the last episode, we were in such a rush, and just like we are now, we're in a rush because we get started too late. But I was going to mention that I did get my numbers back from the doctor's office, and as I feared, my cholesterol was a lot higher than I like it to be. I also recently had a colonoscopy, which was my first time. It was not that bad at all, so I would like to make that suggestion to anybody out there. If you know, if you're in reaching your 40s, it's time to maybe start late 40s
in your 50s. Yeah, most people get them early 50s, okay. Late 40s, early 50s.
Well, either way, don't be too scared of it. They put you right to sleep, you wake up, and you're all clean. And it was real easy the night before, you know, taking that stuff, drinking that stuff to where you've got to clean your body out for hours. That wasn't fun, but was no big deal. So get yourself.
What about the not eating for a day?
That was hard. Hardest. Yeah, not so you couldn't. I couldn't. I had to fast for a whole day. That was hard. So the reason I'm going into that is because I am down 9 pounds just from the last 3 weeks when I found out about my cholesterol. So I'm down 9 pounds, and I just made a few little adjustments. I've had to do it before.
How do you feel about that?
Being down 9 pounds?
Yeah.
I feel pretty. I am happy, but what's crazy is I still have about 19 pounds I still got to lose. Where am I keeping it all? Well, you should see.
In your beard?
No, in my belly. I guess that was all. Those were all the things that I definitely had written down. I mean, I have a bunch of other stuff, but I can save those again for a different episode. Oh, did you have anything you wanted to say before we let Eli in and have a chat with him?
No, not necessarily.
I did want to say this because Eli, who is our guest, today, he is a member of the Living Legends. Also, a member of the Living Legends is Merce. And I the other day I heard Merce, I saw a video that Merce posted. He was talking about how when he was in Ethiopia, they was walking down the street with a friend of his who was Ethiopian there, and the guy kept trying to reach and grab his hand, to hold his hand. Because that's normal. That's
common.
It's common. Yeah, it was normal.
And I think Muslim culture.
And Merce was kind of like uncomfortable, like, oh, no, dude, I don't want to do that. But then it started to rain, and so... Merce was like, hey, let's pop into this shop right here so I can get an umbrella. And the guy told Merce, if you get an umbrella, I'm going to have to walk on the other side of the street because that is considered unmanly.
Umbrella?
Yeah. <Huh? laughs> In the rain. So it was just funny, the different cultures, like holding hands. Mm-hmm. But what I found interesting... the reason I was bringing that up, what I found is interesting, is it doesn't matter. It's not just an American culture. It's culture all across the world. Somehow there's a thing that men do that makes them go like, oh, I can't do that because it's not manly. It doesn't matter what country you're from or anything. Being not manly is like a thing that men seem to worry about.
There's a flip side to that.
Yeah.
It's not ladylike.
Yeah. It's just interesting, right? I don't know. Well, okay, I was going to get that out. Oh, you know what? We might be going to Samoa.
Maybe right. Not.
But just recently, kind of a thing had come up.
I was looking at tickets. Maybe not.
I haven't been to Samoa since I got my title, my chief title, my Luamanu Vai title. So I got really excited about going. I sometimes get anxiety about going because it's just so far and so expensive. But then some things came up. My aunt is being given a very, very special title, a really important title, chief title that has been vacant for about 20 years. 40 years. I mean, it's a pretty massive title. And my dad would have been the first one to get that, but he has passed away. And my aunt, she's living in Samoa currently. So it's a huge honor. And she's getting that, the title. You know, they have the big ceremonies. Anyway, that's in April. So I was bringing it up because I'm excited. I was excited that we started talking about going, and then some other things.
Then we jumped right back on the roller coaster.
I know. So we're in a roller coaster, but listen,
this whole year is going to be a roller coaster year.
With some other family stuff. But yeah, so we might be going to Samoa in April, and I'm hoping we are able to just because...
Well, I was looking at tickets again today, and not only has the flight time increased from 25 to 35 hours, the price has gone up significantly.
Yeah, it's expensive to get over there. Once we're there, we got a home in Samoa, so it's free once we're there. okay, we're gonna take a quick break and have Eli in. Well, he'll be in after the break. Before we do that, I do want to bring up a few things in case you're not aware of who Eli is. I have been a longtime fan of Eli's. He's the founding member of 3MGs. That's Three Melancholy Gypsies. That's him, Scarab, and Merce. That later became the Living Legends. Our kids, when they were growing up, one of their favorite songs that was always in their playlists, one of their favorite songs ever, has the Nirvana sample in it. That song's called 2010.
Not with the cost of the company that's hogging up your artery cholesterol, but it's when it's so thickly sticky, fingers grabbing the sharp end of a box cutter.
bleeding the blood of a soldier older. Wiser, colder arena saturated with hitters, disintegrate with atom bomb.
Drop it,
now they gone.
Stop it.
As I pilot my palm on the boss, holler my name in the shadows, looking the nemesis. Better let a veteran headed you off at the pass. Last samurai, deep sea diving my debonair, divine mind to shatter your glass house. Stone face, gray, straight laced with mace. Beautiful, irritant, omnipotent crow, crawling around in your conscious, raising my wings, darting tornadoes, tearing your timetables, able to fly without leaving the ground. Cradle the cries of a generation submitted.
That one is a living legend on the Living Legends album, but I guess they call that it's technically a 3MG song. So
when Soul, our son Soul, was just a baby, and he was in one time I went in, he was taking a nap and he was sleeping too long, so I went in to check on him, and I played music during that, and that song was on, and he was just a baby in his crib, and he was up going like this to that song. It was so cute. I wish I would have recorded it, but yes,
it's one of my favorite uses of a Nirvana sample. I mean, I know there's a bunch out there, but it's a cool track, and we're big fans of Living Legends. I keep saying we're. Well, I know you are a fan, but it's an honor to have Eligh on our show. After that, I just wanted to point this out so I can play some clips of some of his music. He did some solo projects. One of his albums that I really love is called Enigma.
I made this beat on a QY. Who's my nemesis now with the premises? Style and the imbecile, foul mouth, down south, general scowl as up in a whole fleet of unique, sleek paragraph, paralyzing, pitiful, weak individuals, creep hands penetrate, paper poet, snake, rip, burn, flip, turn, crisp, turn, build composite, powerful, smile, choke my enemies.
He came out with that in 2005. And prior to that, he came out with an album called Poltergeist.
Life's just a pop fly. To the left field. Shit, I'm with the rep field. We ride high on the trek. Shield to block horizontal slashes. No form of energy crashes into titanium taverns. Towers in front of the castle. Hours spent with hassle makes the spirit get uneasy. Man, it takes too much to please me. Want the shit to come easy. Can't be a gas dreamer, pipe cleaner, misdemeanor, demeanor, beam for the green and cigarette counter people's.
In 2003, both albums are really delicious. He also makes terrific music with another one of my favorite MCs, and that's Grouch. So Grouch and Eligh, they have a few albums. I don't know how many exactly, but two of my favorites of theirs, Say G and E.
Grouch and Eligh, we got the power, and it don't stop, won't stop, wilt nor sour. Grouch and Eligh, that's my brother, can't touch that. Plus raps fit with each other's. G's for the good, E for elevation. We gon' touch the world, this is celebration. Say G and E.
That's a really fantastic album, and The Tortoise and the Crow.
Raindrop pellets on the windowsill. Ain't no telling what the pen gon' spill. Grouch and Eligh, we the men that flow ill. So real, you never see a diamond in the grill. But I can think of a way to make you love me with the skills. Appeal to girls and boys around the world with zeal. Seal cracked open, back up and get deal. Neil, the captain of the ship is on the steel.
Both of those albums are fantastic. Eligh's also made music with Aesop Rock, Epic Beardman. That's Sage Francis and B. Dolan, Henry Osborne, Zion I, and Dale the Funky Homo Sapien. So we're lucky to have him on the show, and I would like to thank Sage Francis for helping facilitate that. I had been talking with Eligh for the last year or so. He and the Grouch were going to be early guests when we were first starting out the show, but then some things kind of fell through, and they had some other projects coming up, and then we just lost touch. And so Sage Francis facilitated this again, and I'm thankful to him, and thanks to Eligh. So we'll take a quick break, and we'll be right back with the real Eligh.
DOD45. Hob Sauce!
We're real thrilled to have partnered with Hob Sauce for three simple reasons. Their hot sauce is delicious, the owner and creator David is a solid dude, and they collaborate with dope artists for their labels, including myself. Boom! Amplify your favorite foods with their award-winning flavors. Head over to HobSauces.com to get yourself some absolutely delicious artisan hot sauce. Hit it, Bobby.
Hab sauce. What you gonna do? What you gonna do? Put it on your food.
Hab sauce.
This is flyover country. No one's expecting much from us. In fact, no one's expecting anything at all. The coast probably think we're at Walmart right now.
Great deal on our 5, by the way.
Instead, Here we are making plans. Big plans. Because in a city where people do so much with so little, what could happen if we gave them more? More beauty, connections, perspectives. This is your chance to be a part of something bigger than yourself. Something that's made of brick, concrete, and steel. But also for blood, sweat, and soul. Something that can only be possible in St. Louis. Because when no one's expecting much from you, you can do anything. Our city deserves something epic. Long live Laborious.
Check out our new partners, Brim of the World, a.k.a. Sea Conquer and Destroy, a.k.a. Aliens Built Earth. I'm always wearing their gear, especially the hats, and in almost every episode of the DOD45, you'll see me rocking something from these cats, because I'm a fan. Show them some love and treat yourself right to a new wardrobe or some new headgear, and I'm not talking about braces headgear, I'm talking about hats. Check out all their gear and links at brimoftheworld.com. Hey, real quick, my friends, my art is available for purchase at ArtByTai.com, so if you like what you're seeing or you want to support the DOD45 show, the best way for you to do that is to pick up a print or an original at my website. If you're not quite ready to buy but you still want to help out, leave us a review on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever else you stream from, and make sure you subscribe to my YouTube channel at ArtByTai and engage in the comments. That goes a long way. All right, enough already. Let's get back to the show. All right, welcome back. Here he is. Here we go.
What's up? We're back. Guys.
Eligh, how are you?
I'm good, brother. How are you?
Fantastic. I want to thank you from the bottom of my souls for joining us on our show today. It's really an honor to have you on the show.
Hey, it's good to be here. It's an honor to be wanted to be somewhere. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely. Before we get started, I wanted to ask you, did I just forget to do something, Adrienne?
I don't know.
Hi, how are you, Adrienne?
I'm good, thanks.
I don't usually drink coffee this late in the afternoon, and I just pounded a coffee and I can feel my tea, brains. Bro.
You gotta do tea in the afternoon, man.
I normally do a hot tea, but now my brain's like.
Apologies, guys, for the leaf blowers and fucking gardening tools going on.
Because you're in LA.
Yes. How did you guess? It's LA gardening hour right now.
Oh, it's funny. Anytime we have a guest in that is in LA, that's usually what's happening.
Dude, if there's a reason to leave LA besides the money and getting how expensive it is, it's the fucking gardeners, dude. Like, I'm sorry, they're doing it. They got to do their thing. But man, it's annoying. Can't stand it. I was just here contemplating, what do I dislike more? Flies? Or leaf blowers? I'm like, flies is number one.
Flies.
Leaf blowers is a close second, dude.
Oh, yeah. You guys don't have much of a mosquito issue out there, do you?
Oh, man. There's been bad mosquitoes in the last couple years, especially in the valley where I live. Like, this last summer, there was these tiny little guys with white stripes that were just terrorizing.
Oh, yeah. Those zebra ones.
Yeah. Those zebra striped mosquitoes are the worst.
They're the worst. Yeah. And you know, I have a 2-year-old now, so when we're outside trying to play, as soon as the sun starts going down, it's like we gotta run inside, like vampires are coming, dude. We gotta go. Indoors quick. Yeah, yeah, dude. I can't stand mosquitoes are up there. Maybe mosquitoes are number one, actually.
Yeah, those are my number one.
Oof, I can't stand mosquitoes.
Yeah. I have to say I love my leaf blower.
Oh, you love your leaf blower. Well, there have now silent leaf blowers. I mean, can we just go there? Like, they're electric. You don't need a motor gas going.
Ours is electric.
Yeah, ours is electric, so it's not as loud as those gas-powered ones that are destroying the earth.
Yeah, dude. Well, I am now in a zone where a leaf blower myself is on the docket at some point. I do not own a home yet, so I assume that's going to be one of the first things I get when I own a home.
And then someone will be filming or doing a podcast next door, and they'll be bitching about you.
Exactly. Using your leaf blower. Dude, by then, it's going to be super silent, man. It'll just be Tesla of leaf blowers, man. That's my goal. So this is cool, dude. You're actually gonna draw while we're talking.
Yeah. So before I start the timer, I am gonna draw you an owl.
But before I start the timer, I did want to ask you why an owl? What significance does an owl have for you?
You know what? I was just literally trying to answer that question for myself the other day, because I've been, the crow is actually, I feel like, my spirit animal. Like the crows have been where I live my whole life. Anywhere we moved, there's always crows. My mom and I both identify with the crow a lot, and hence, like, I have albums with crow in it. I go by Gray Crow. Like, it's a part of my whole thing. But owls, something about that bird, it's, you know, I'm an artist as well, and I draw owls more than any other creature, especially when I'm like, I want to draw right now, but I just completely am drawing a blank. I don't know what to draw. Fuck it, let's draw an owl. I never go wrong with drawing owls. And they, to me, like, if I hear an owl in the neighborhood, I just stop everything I'm doing. I'm like, where's the owl? Like, they're just like the most mystical, magical creature of all, man. Like, there's something alien about them. Something like, they know something we don't, type of shit.
And, oh, they definitely do.
Yeah. And you know, as an artist myself, I love drawing them because of that. And I love their giant eyes, and they just have a look about them that draws me to them. But yeah, that was the first thing that came to my head.
Yeah. Well, I'm glad. It's cool that you say you like owl is your default when you're kind of struggling. Mine is an octopus, and I hate drawing tentacles, but anytime I'm like stuck somewhere, I'm like, I'll throw in some tentacles.
Dude, I've only drawn like one or two, maybe just one octopus piece in my whole drawing career, dude. And it came out fire, but no, that's not true. There's two, but I do love, the flowiness of octopus and the tentacles, and how you can make it look like there's a lot of movement with a still drawing with.
Yeah. Drawing, there's so much movement. Yeah. All right. Well, I've set the timer 45 minutes. I'll start drawing this, and I got some questions I'm going to throw at you. Mm-hmm. The first one I'll ask you is, if you had to switch lives with one of these people at their highest points for just a week, who would you choose? Eli Manning or Eli Roth?
Eli Manning.
Yeah. But would it be what I think? I'm pretty sure he has a Super Bowl.
Yes, he does. That's when I was switch places with him for that game and the few days after, or that day.
Yeah. Are you a sports fan?
Huge NFL person. And it's only because, well, I've always liked football, but about 12 years ago, I started playing fantasy football, and then I just became obsessed. Now I'm just ridiculous. I know every player on every team. It's like no one should know the information I know, man. So,
have you been doing it?
Twelve years.
Do you manage leagues, or are you just a participant in a league?
No, I'm just a participant.
Yeah,
I have really one main league with a bunch of friends, and it's kind of one of the best parts about it is staying in contact with these friends during that time of the year is super fun. But the buy-in is, you know, buy-in's like $530. It's not nothing. And it's just hyper competitive. And I've been good since day one. I won, like, swept the league in year one, and I've won more than anybody else because I have that addict obsessive mind.
Sure.
Once I lock into something, it's hard to keep me from winning, man. I'm gonna get there.
So you, out of the 12 years, how many do you think you've won?
I've won three Super Bowls, like 2 points overall titles, but I've been to six Super Bowls.
Wow.
Lost three, won three. So I like to talk shit to my league mates. Like, you know, I've been in the Super Bowl more times than you made the playoffs, motherfucker. Don't talk to me. Like,
you're like the Patriots.
I am like the Patriots.
When you say you've been, does that mean your fantasy football team has made it to, or you've been in the stands at the actual Super Bowl?
Oh, no, it football. Means my fantasy football team okay. made it
have
to
you, have you ever been to an NFL or a Super Bowl game?
No, dude. You know that I've literally only been to one football game in my life, and it was with the LA Raiders. So that can tell you what year that was. And I was a kid, obviously. My dad took me. I remember being nervous, excited. It was like, dude, imagine being at a Raiders game in LA in the 80s. And the vibe there was like, you know, it was nuts. People were like yelling at each other, fights in the stands. Like, it was crazy. It was at, I think their stadium was, dang, it's where the Trojans play right now, or where they've been playing for.
Oh,
like, that's by USC over there.
Yeah.
So do you guys have a football team again?
The LA? Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Rams.
They got the Rams back. Oh, that's right.
Okay. Got that, the Rams
so
back.
Rams was in Detroit.
No, it went to St. Louis. It went to St. Louis. They won the Super Bowl in St. Louis, and then they went back.
Clearly, I don't know. But the color of the Rams is like the same color of the Lions, I think, right?
They got blue.
It's
they
kind of. It's blue, yellow. Okay. Yeah. The Lions are blue, white. Here's another Sophie's Choice then. I like that you, I'm glad that you're a football fan, because that made that easier.
Yeah.
Are you a horror movie fan at all?
Yes, I am, sir.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, Eli Roth made some good ones. I'm particularly not a great fan of like the Saw movie. He did Saw, right?
I think he did Saw, yeah. Or yeah. He did Hostel, one of those.
Oh, yeah. Hostel. You're right. It was Hostel.
That's what he did.
Yeah, those ones are not my style, like old school, horror movies. Yeah. But if you could only watch one of these Nathan Lane movies for the rest of your life, which Nathan would you Lane? Choose?
Okay.
The Birdcage or The Producers?
Birdcage, 100,000%, bro.
Awesome.
What a good question. How little do you know that I've watched Birdcage 1,000 times, because I just love that movie. I love Robin Williams. I love most anything he does, like Mrs. Doubtfire, all these classic Robin Williams movies I've watched a million times. And anytime I think about him, it makes me sad, because he just was such a light. You know what I mean? Anywhere he went, all his stand up, the movies, people love him. And it just goes to show you, when you're suffering with depression and addiction, it doesn't matter how much love people have for you. You know, when life can be unbearable. And then it's just like,
well, didn't he also get diagnosed with some disease?
Well, he had a heart attack
before.
He had a heart transplant, dude. Like,
yeah.
He had valves replaced. Like, he had he had major heart issues, and it was from, I think, related to his cocaine addiction and alcohol and all that stuff. And so he had this huge surgery a few years back or whatever. And yeah, man, just a sad story, but
it really is. And it is exactly like you said. It just goes to show, like, you really have no idea what someone's going through, because you could go back and watch. I mean, he's got hours and hours and hours and hours of film, and even just like live stand-up. You would never, ever see that he was someone that was,
suffering.
In pain. Yeah. So, yeah.
I mean, how would you would have known to ask about Nathan Lane movies? How many of your guests would have actually said, I've never seen either of them?
Well, I'll tell you what, when I was thinking about it, when I come up with any of the questions, I'm always often like, well, it could either be a pin drop or maybe it's something that they're into. Either way, it's worth the shot. Hey, what's a better name for a nacho bar? Nacho Daddy or Nacho Libre?
Nacho Daddy, man. Nacho Daddy.
That's good. We have a Nacho Daddy here in Salt Lake City, a nacho bar called Nacho Daddy.
Oh, that's where you're at too, Salt Lake. Nice, man.
Yeah. Yeah, you're going to be here in Salt Lake on the 25th.
I'm about to say, bro, you got to come through, man.
I know, we're going to be in Miami, so I know, I'm so bummed, because Urban Lounge is like my joint. I love that spot, and I was really excited to see you guys are going to be this way. But you guys come through Salt Lake quite a bit, don't you?
Well, it's been a minute. It's been a minute, but it's only been a minute because of COVID and all the craziness. But yeah, we definitely come to Salt Lake on our runs often, more often than not.
Yeah, it's not a spot that a lot of like hip hop artists want to skip, because there's always been some good love out of Salt Lake, and there's there are people that like to get down here. So
absolutely.
Well, that's too bad. I'm sorry that we're going to miss you.
I know. I was bummed when I saw.
Going to the Birdcage instead.
But that's short. Like, you guys are doing, I think, Billings, Montana, somewhere in Arizona. And it's a short one.
Sure. It's a little guy. Yeah. And you know what? At this point in my life, like, Grouch knows, I don't want to do long tours anymore, especially with a 2-year-old at home. I want to be home.
But what about this? Whose show would you rather perform live on? The Tonight Show with Jimmy Fallon or with Johnny Carson?
Jimmy Fallon or Johnny Carson? Jimmy Fallon, man. Johnny is it's a different generation. I don't think I could relate to that dude at all. I think Jimmy Fallon, I could at least be entertained, and he's goofy. I like that guy.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like if I was ever not that it would ever happen, but I would really fucking love to perform with the Roots, like doing backup for me. Like, that's that would be fucking awesome.
Oh, that part, yeah. That part is pretty freaking cool.
He does fun things with his guests too, doesn't he? Like, he does musicians.
Skits, music stuff. Yeah. It's just silly, funny shit. You know what I mean? I think, but to retract to what I was actually, when I was saying when I got that text, is that I don't, you know, long tours used to be what we did all the time. We go on, leave for a month and a half, 2 months. Like, at this point, I'm like, nope, not for me anymore. Give me the little mini runs, you know, like 6 shows, come home, then do 3 shows next month, and, you know, 6 shows the next time, and just do these small runs. Maybe when my daughter gets a little older, maybe I'll go on some. It just depends on what the run is, you know what I mean, at this point for me. But yeah, at this, you know, family's first now at this
point. Would you want it? Would you, when she's older, would you, was that something you think you would enjoy taking her on the road with you? Or do you think that?
No, I don't think so, man. It's just, it's such a tiring thing. And this is what I tell people at this point, is that if there was one part of what I do that I am perfectly content with retiring from, it's touring. And it's not because I still do not enjoy and feel like I perform on stage at a high level, because I do, because I just feel like I do. I'm still at my peak as far as that goes, but it's everything around it, dude. It's being in a van for 12 hours, getting out of the van, being like, God damn, I'm just, it's too, you know, if you're not a huge superstar, performs in stadiums and gets flown in private jets and like on buses and just living that life, it's still hard doing that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm just, you know, I love performing, but I don't love it enough to keep beating myself up on the road like that. There's so many things that I want to do and am doing that I can do from home with my family. So, you know, I want to continue that stuff.
Well, and do you feel like the whole thing with COVID sort of helped kind of open that up? I mean, we noticed that with a lot of people we talk with, is it gave you a sense of like, oh, I can actually do this without fucking going on the road for
nine months. It's pretty trippy how that happened. And I think it was a blessing in disguise for a lot of people. In many ways. I mean, obviously I had my daughter, we made her during quarantine. Yeah. So that was a huge blessing. You know what I mean? And just in general, like you said, yeah, I realized, oh, I can actually get by, and not only get by, thrive with working from home now, and drawing a lot for people, doing that a lot more, jumping into the Web3 NFT space was a huge thing for me. And I'm still going heavy in that space. And the whole motivation behind even doing that was being able to do it from home, man. Yeah. So, and realizing that's what really took the pressure off of this thought that I have to tour, I have to go out, I have to leave, because how else am I going to be able to pay the bills? And like, no, I need it still, but I don't have to go away for long periods of time. I could do 1 or 2 or 3 shows a month, and even skip a month and be okay.
Yeah, and you also forget, even just living on the road costs money, so it becomes a you know, it's expensive.
Right.
And then when you don't do it, you're like, oh, wow, I'm saving a bunch of money not eating out all the time, or, you know, hotel stay and all that.
I mean, at this point, like, I'm Uber eating everything to wherever I'm staying. And Grouch and I get Airbnbs every night instead of a hotel, which saves us a little bit of money. But no, it's expensive to tour. And that's why it's like, if we don't sell some merch at the shows, then we're not really doing that great. Like, you know, we get guarantees at the shows, and if a lot of people show up and we hit other numbers and get some bonuses here and there, but, you know, at this point, you know, especially after COVID, like, people are still hesitant. People are coming out, but it's not what it was before. And I wouldn't expect it to be, but that just means like, we're doing smaller rooms, you get smaller guarantees, so we got to kill it on the merch, or it's just not really making it. So I've been really concentrating on like making really dope merch and bringing my art to the merch table at shows. So I've been making like canvas prints that, you know, the whole name of the game for me is limited, right? So if I make canvas prints of a piece that I drew, I'll do 10 of them only, and I'll put 1 of 10 and sign it, 2 of 10, 3 of 10, and I'll sell those canvases for, you know, $200 a piece, as opposed to what if it wasn't, it was like 40, 50.
Yeah.
And I can do that because I'm making 10 only. I'm never going to make them again. So I try to make, like, I've been doing that. I've been making skateboard decks with my art on it and on them. And the, you know, and the normals, the hoodies, the hats, the
all that. Yeah. It's well, yeah. Well, I have a couple quick questions on that. Are you still in the space? Do you feel like the people aren't going out to the shows? It's a COVID thing, or is it something else? Are you
I think it's a COVID thing.
Okay. Okay.
But also, you know, shit, man, Grouch and I mean, Sage, all of us have been doing this 25 plus years.
Yeah.
Like, our fans, our people that support us and come to shows, they're aging with us, man. It's like, yep, we're turning into a bunch of old motherfuckers in the club. Like, so some people are just they have complete full families and they're just not coming out like they used to be. Now we have young people in the audience, and on this last run, we did Sacramento, man. It was packed to the rim. People show, it was like a throwback energy feeling of the show itself. And guess what? There was fans there that were our age, that were younger, they had their kids. Cool. So there was 10-year-old, 13-year-olds in the front row. They were going nuts. I was like, I love seeing kids at the shows now.
Well, and that's what I was going to ask you. So, yeah, we're actually going to shows more than ever now because our kids are now 16 and 15. We can leave them at home for long periods of time. But a lot of people our age had kids, or, you know, are just having kids now. They so they're still young. But I was thinking, it is cool because, like, we'll take our kids to shows of who we're fans of. So, or they'll become fans of the music that they were listening to all this time. Like, we were just talking about in the intro, one of our son's favorite song when he was in the crib was 2010, the 3MG song. Played it all the time. Like, anytime it comes on now, he's like, you can see that he just remembers it since he was a kid. Wow. And he's heard it all the time. But I don't know.
I think for indoor artists, musicians and stuff, I think this is going to be your year. I know right after COVID, 2021 is when, so we do a lot of outside things. That was our year. But I think for the inside artists, I think that this is going to be your year. We went to a few shows last year that were, you know, it indoors. Was light. There weren't very many people, but I think this is going to be the one for you.
Yeah. Well, and it's good that you have artwork to sell too, because with music being on the digital, it's hard to fuck it. I don't know.
Didn't even have to finish the sentence.
Hey, what do you think would be a good cereal box prize?
What would be a good cereal box?
I don't think they even do that anymore, do they?
And it's like $6 a box for a box of cereal, and you don't even get a prize.
I'm trying to remember what the prizes were when we were younger and how freaking excited I was to get a prize.
I got some Pez ones that came out of a cereal boxes that I still have the Pez.
Yeah, what were prizes? They were like little dispensers. Squirt guns or what?
Not squirt guns, but like it would be little things like that. Oftentimes stickers and stuff, I think. Or
stickers. Yeah. Stickers are great.
Oh, I love stickers so much.
But my favorite, like, little prize I would get back in the day was the McDonald's Happy Meals that had freaking Playmobil, which was, I don't know if you guys.
Oh, yeah. Playmobil, the little people without figures. Legs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the little hands like Lego men, like this. They're like, oh, no, no. But there was this little sheriff with a rifle and a rocking chair. And I fucking remember it because I loved it so much. I went on eBay to look for it and I found him a bunch of Playmobil McDonald's 80s Happy Meal toys. And I'm like, shit like that, little figurines that move and stuff. You put that in a cereal box, dude. Come on.
Yeah. That's
awesome. Yeah, I don't remember these. I'm looking at them now. They had Ronald McDonald.
Oh, God.
All
the McDonald's characters for sure. And it's so funny because my daughter will never know what McDonald's is. She'll never even fucking know.
Until she goes to grandma's. See? I said that.
I know. Well, and then yeah. Well, now our kids would never. But
no.
Well, hey, who crushes it without fail every time they put words to music?
Kendrick Lamar.
Oh, cool.
That dude crushes it every time. I haven't listened to a song by him and be like, that's a terrible song. Like, no.
Right.
Even ones that they're not my quote unquote favorite song, he still crushes it, man. Especially on this new album, dude. Because he went very deep talking about subject matter that no one talks about at his level, where he's at in the game. It's very refreshing to know that an artist of his caliber at the top of the pile is talking about real shit on his album,
man. Yeah. Can I ask you something real quick? Who do you feel paved the way for him to be able to do that?
Well, obviously, all the I think all the underground artists, like, you know, us, like,
yeah,
Legends, like, you know, Strange Famous, like, Atmosphere, all these guys and women and men who have spoken honestly and truthfully and been, you know, emotionally involved dense music. And Kendrick definitely heard some of that. Not to say, yeah, he heard any of us, but he's heard somebody that made music like that, because he became that kind of artist. And he's got, and the older he gets and the further he goes in, the more he exposes, like, the vulnerability. And that's what I tell, you know, artists that ask me, like, what advice would you give, you know, a younger artist who's just coming in that wants to, you know, do what you're doing, etc. I'm just like, vulnerability, be as vulnerable as possible with your music, because that is how you make lifelong connections and lifelong supporters. When someone identifies with you emotionally, mm-hmm, they tend to stick with you for a long time. If you're, yeah, just making surface shit that might sound good or whatever, it's just like, oh, I like this, and then toss it, don't really have any emotional attachment to it. But when you make deep shit just when you talk authentically about you and what you're going through and real feelings and real things, that's when people gravitate to and stay around.
Yeah, the audience gravitates to authenticity. That's what I tell young artists all the time. They say, how do you get to your... I said, just, there's no correct way. It's just be fucking authentic and passionate about what you do, and somehow it works out.
Right.
Hey, do you have a favorite TV show from when you were growing up?
Dukes of Hazzard.
Oh, wow.
It's so funny because Dukes of Hazzard, it was like a Friday night treat that my parents would let me stay up and watch it. And then I remember it's just burned into my head. Once the Dallas theme song came on, that means it's time to go to bed. Like, every time, like, Dallas came on right after Dukes of Hazzard. I am, like, aging myself so hardcore right now, but Dukes of Hazzard, it was like a fucking, like, my mom, you know, my parents were, my mom was liberal, fucking, you know, like, she was, it made her sick that I love this show about some good old boys, like, fucking General Lee, like, what the fuck was, like, what were they doing putting that on TV? And I loved it. I have no idea why. I loved it. I loved that show. And Cosby Show, that was one of my favorites too. Not gonna lie, that's so sad.
Proof,
but,
well, these are all proof of all the things you just don't realize when you're younger.
we didn't know. Hey, no. But those were from childhood. Those two shows stick out the most for sure.
Oh, so I enjoyed both of them as well. I found that my appreciation for Dukes of Hazzard led me into really enjoying things like Cannonball Run and the other one with Burt Reynolds. The other show. I don't know, but I don't know. Maybe it was the Cars or something. A-Team, all that shit.
Definitely,
you know?
The Cars.
It was a car time.
Yeah,
it was a car time.
No, really,
it really was, because you can ask people of our generation like a question you can ask people is like, what was your favorite car? Nowadays, 16-year-olds don't even have their driver's license. They don't even care to have it. Like,
well, they all kind of look the same. What was that talking car show?
That was Kit.
Knight Rider was one.
Knight Rider.
It was like everything was about cars.
And it was. That theme song is the best of any fucking show ever. So hard. That fucking... That shit is fire, man.
Hey, here's a question based on one of your songs. which has had a bigger impact on American society or American pop culture? Olympic competitor Picaboo or beauty pageant competitor Honey Boo Boo?
Fucking Honey Boo Boo. And you know what, dude? I don't even know much about Honey Boo Boo at all. I didn't watch that shit, whatever show she was on. And she blew
me either.
You know, I was like, I didn't know if it was a fat older woman, excuse me, a large older woman, or like this little kid. I didn't know who was what, and still know nothing about it, because to me, those kind of shows, I'm just so turned off by. I don't mess with it. But I know just the name Honey Boo Boo was everywhere, so I think that.
Yeah, you're right. You could ask anyone today if they know Picaboo Street or Honey Boo Boo, and I'm sure they would say Honey Boo Boo.
Peek-a-boo Street, baby.
Honey Boo Boo, whatever her name was. She was more recent than Peek-a-boo Street.
I understand that, but I'm just saying, like, I don't know, that whole reality television thing.
I know. It's so bad.
I don't know where that came from in my psyche when I was writing that song.
I see you, you see me, we see us. Peek-a-boo Street, I see you. C3s when I bust, Picaboo Street, right, left, right, sight on bright, red light, heat, Picaboo Street, you might not know, but when I done flow, you're gonna know about me on the Picaboo Street, man. I see you, you see me, we see us, Picaboo Street, I see you, you see threes when I bust, Picaboo Street.
Just said Picaboo Street, I'm like, what am I fucking even talking about? It didn't matter. In my mind, I have a very abstract way of thinking about things. In my mind, it made sense. I would have to actually go back and read what I was saying to try and figure out what I meant at the moment. But Peekaboo Street, yeah, that was an Olympic name that stayed in my head, obviously.
It's a great name.
Peekaboo Street? That's a fire name, dude.
I am curious to know if anyone out there, if there's any other people named Peekaboo, because it is, yeah, that's a kick-ass name.
Yeah, she must have got so good.
Hey, would you rather get a tattoo of the Night of the Living Dead poster or lyrics from Bon Jovi's Living on a Prayer?
Night of the Living Dead. Dude. I love that movie.
It's good.
That movie was fucking... It was funny and horrible at the same time. Like, there was some funny ass shit.
Are you a Bon Jovi fan at all?
I actually am. I don't mind Bon Jovi, and I like all the corny shit he did. Yeah. I love the Young Guns songs that he did, or song. I think he did multiple songs on that.
I think he did the whole album.
He did the whole album for the Young Guns 2, yeah.
Oh, right.
Yeah, I love a lot of that 80s nostalgic hair band shit. Like, whereas back then, I probably didn't like it at all. It was all hip-hop, didn't care about anything else.
Right.
But now I look back and I love it. I play it in the car and I just think it's great. People don't make that music anymore. And if they try, it's not the same. It's just, it was a whole vibe back then, for sure.
Yeah, it really was. How do you choose what you'll be getting tattooed? And do you still have room?
I do have plenty of room. My whole back is open, bro. Like, I stopped a few years ago. I just was like, my body was not recovering or reacting well to it, like, anymore. Not like I was like breaking out rashes or anything, but it was like, it would beat me up. My immune system would be dropped. I'd get sick. I'd be like, you know, down. Like, I the last big one I got was Ice Cube on my calf, side of my leg, and is pretty big. And it was the only color tattoo that I've ever got. All the rest are black and gray. And that shit messed me up. I was limping around, blood, you know how the blood just fills up in the area. And I was like, dude, I don't know how many more of these I could take. And then, you know, I've been seeing naturopaths and homeopathic doctors for a long time, since I was 20. I've been going that route as opposed to Western medicine. And I have one homeopathic doctor who, every time I see her, she was like, you know, did you get any tattoos? I'm like, no, I haven't. She's like, good, stop that shit. I'm like, because in her, what she believed, and I agree with her because it makes sense, is that tattoos are slowly forever leaching into your body. So the ink just doesn't just sit here. It's like slowly leaching heavy metals into your body. And if you're like me, who's super sensitive to heavy metals and environment and toxins and stuff, and doesn't move them well without help, then it's just bad news for you. And So I kind of laid back off a bit.
Does that mean it's the end of tattoos for you, or?
No, I wouldn't say the end. I just get little ones, and I tend to get them when my wife and I go travel somewhere. We might. Yeah. Like last one I got was in Kauai, and my wife and I got. I got a chicken and she got a hen on our ankles, like, because there's a ton of chickens running around.
Yeah.
Hawaii.
Yeah.
And so we do shit like that. Like there's a couple tattoo artists that are so ridiculously dope that if I ever had a chance and it made sense, I might just have to do it. But
yeah,
I don't really want to, put any more pressure on my body when I'm trying to right now, being a dad of a 2-year-old, like, you guys know, like, at this point, and I started late. Like, I had
my it's a marathon.
Had my first kid at what, 42, right? She's 2 now, and I'm just exhausted all the time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Number 2, like, I have, since she's been born, I've been just wondering, how am I going to get my ass back into exercising? I eat, my wife and I eat really well. I mean, we eat better than most people we know. We're not vegan, but if you take the fish out of our diet, we eat fish, but if you take that out, we live a completely clean lifestyle, you know, gluten-free, soy-free, corn-free, you know, dairy-free, hella free, like all the foods that you can have, because we have a lot of allergies to stuff, nuts, like, and our baby is super sensitive too. Our kid is sensitive. So that's good. But like, I feel sluggish because I haven't worked out in 2 years, dude. I swear to God, the only working out I do is when I take my daughter on walks or run around and play with her. And sometimes I'll run around the house with her and the dog, and I'm just like, hold on. I'm like, dude, that's so sad, dude.
No, it is a lot of work.
If you're going on tour here that's soon, exercise. A little mini tour, you'll be getting back into it. You're going to have to, right?
I've done prep. Two runs recently, and I still am jumping around on stage, still have my breath control intact, and it's more like muscle memory, you know what I mean?
Right.
At this point, and
something else takes over.
Man, I couldn't imagine doing that. That seems really hard, like going away for, I mean, it's easier for some people. I don't imagine it's very easy for you, but yeah, being away from your child at home when you're on the road, even if it's a couple of weeks, even if it's a week or two, that's difficult. You know,
but also it's hard for me to leave my wife just to do everything, because she's, you know, being a mom is the hardest job I've ever seen in existence in life. And moms, in my opinion, moms should be paid by the government, like, to be there, to be able to be present at home with the kids, because it's the hardest job ever to me.
Yeah. And I'd vote for that.
Fulfilling and amazing and all that stuff. But to leave her to do everything while I'm gone 24 hours with the kid that we have. And that's another thing that I've learned since becoming a parent. Nobody's situation is the same. And I will never offer unsolicited advice to new parents ever, because when somebody is having a hard time with the kid sleeping or whatever, and I'm like, have you tried going? It's like, yes, we tried that, motherfucker. We tried everything. Thank you very much. I'm never going to do this. I'm just going to be an ear. You know what I mean? And my wife and I chose maybe not what the mainstream would do as far as like sleep training and all that stuff. My wife decided early that we were going to co-sleep. She was going to breastfeed until the kid was done, whatever age that was. And we weren't going to do sleep training because neither of us, you know, believed that it had any positive impacts as on us as humans. So, and everybody has, all parents have different opinions, and that's, it's all about being able to hear each other and not be so fucking judgmental. Like, what are you doing?
You got to do what works for you.
That's right.
You do. Exactly. And your family.
And so all that being said, this path is, it's harder. It's a little bit harder because, you know, but I think our daughter chose us for parents because she knew we would be the way we are with her. And she needs us to be that way. And she's an amazing kid. And, you know, she's going to grow up. I was just reading a baby book. I laugh about this all the time. There's notes in there that my mom wrote. It said 22 months, favorite foods. brownies, pickles, Oreos, cheese. I'm like, of course brownies and fucking Oreos are my favorite food. You give that to me and, you know, my daughter's not eating that shit. She's not getting any of that.
It was the 80s. Funny, dude.
And that was the 80s.
And she was probably working mom.
Oh, and no judgment.
Yes, pickles for dinner. Hot dogs again.
Dude, hot dogs.
The 80s.
He loves cheese and Oreos. I'm like, yeah. but yeah, man, just, you know, people will do what they need to do as parents. And I never will ever sit there and judge another parent because it's hard, man. It's hard and it's amazing and all that good stuff. And trying to stay creative with the energy it requires to create and also not getting the sleep you used to get and being present as a dad, it's been actually less of a challenge than I thought it would be. I had this whole selfish mindset that, oh, I need my sleep. If I don't get my sleep, I'm fucked. If I'm not going to be able to bring in the money for the fam if I can't create and I need my sleep. But all of that is like, yeah, but guess what? If your wife is doing everything and she's losing her fucking mind from sleep deprivation, then the whole ship goes down. Everything. Yep. If the mom goes down, we all go down. So it's like, fuck your little sleepies. You know, dad, step up to the fucking plate and do and you know, be here and be, you know, be a partner and be someone that's going to, you know, help carry the weight in a more 50-50 realm, not just like, you know, that excuse. Well, I'm, you know, I make the money. So, you know, that's part. Yeah. But, you know, yeah. Your partner needs help. So, you know, trying to, you know, really like changing my mindset on all that and still learning day by day learning.
But it seems like you're the, like, it is perfect for you because you're the type to learn from your, I mean, just, you know, based off of your life history, you're good at learning what you're learning from or implementing what you've learned.
Right on, bro. I mean,
yeah.
Awareness for me has always been key. Once I become aware of something that is damaging to me or the people around me or something that just generally I need to change, awareness, without awareness, there's no growth. There's no change. Once I become aware and I catch myself doing it, you know, whatever it be, I use this analogy all the time, you know, like catching a puppy pissing on the rug and you grab him, nope, and you put him out here. I'm doing that in my head constantly. Mm-hmm. Even the way that we're raising our child with our language, the what we say to her, you know, where I was raised with, no, don't do that.
Right.
It's like, no. And I'll catch myself doing that. And my wife will say, hey, remember we decided not to speak that. It's like, why don't you explain to a child, like, we're not going, or, you know, it's hard to like come up with the words, like, you know, the dog that hurts the dog when you hit them. Let's go over here instead. And why don't we pet them instead of no, don't do that. It's like, that shit doesn't work. And, you know, it's like, well, let's try something new. And it's challenging, but awareness is key. Absolutely, bro.
Yeah. Awareness and patience.
And patience, which has never been one of my top.
Me too.
You'll get it.
Never been.
It'll arrive. Well, when we were speaking about tattoos, one of the things that we do on the show is a useless fact. So I have a useless fact about tattoos. I'm going to use, there's actually two of them. The Medical Pathology Museum in Tokyo, at the Tokyo University, they have more than 100 human pelts of Yakuza full body suits.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was collected by pathologist Dr. Masayuki Fukushi.
Wow.
So, yeah. And then
I wonder if the families know about that.
Well, yeah, I would imagine so. They probably paid pretty good money for it. And Yakuza is like, they probably... Yeah, it's probably something going down there. That the other one that I was going to mention, because it came up when we were talking about tattoos, was that... most tattoo ink is not vegan.
Yeah.
And it's commonly made out of the charred bones of the fat of dead animals. So I think a lot of people don't realize that. So
yes, my wife does. And so she's, you know, she's got a lot of tattoos as well. And she makes sure that vegan ink is being used. Now it's more widely used for sure.
That's true. I was going to say, I wonder if they changed the ink, which is why your body isn't responding as well.
Maybe, but I would think that pumping dead animal
Yeah, it's probably not good.
Probably was not reacting well to that either. Yeah, that's it's gross to me. It's pretty gross.
yeah, we have. It's not how we did it, or how we did it in Samoa. It was
charcoal.
Yeah, light like the soot from they would burn the soot. That's usually how they use it. But they did use a shark tooth to put it in.
Yeah, that must hurt.
It's actually, you know, it hurts poking, right? Less. Like, yeah, hammer it in. Yeah, it hurts less than the gun, I felt.
Yeah,
yeah, I think.
How many tattoos do you have in that?
I've got quite a few. Oh, and the Samoan one, just my whole shoulder and chest. Wow. Oh, you know what? We have a new segment on our show. Well, we've had these two segments. One of them is a question from Dibs, but Dibs was up all night last night, and so he worked himself out of not being able to put in the question. But we do have a new segment on our show since we've partnered with Strange Famous Records, and it's a video question from Sage, and so we'll play that for you. I don't know. When they send them in to me, I have no idea what it is. I like to watch it with you the first time you're getting it. So I have no idea what it is. It's kind of a new thing that we're going to do on the show. So
that's fine, dude. Shout out to Dib, by the way.
Sage Francis here at Strange Famous Headquarters in Rhode Island. I drove here from Connecticut just so I could make it official, since we are partnering up with the DOD45 podcast show. So shout out to Ty, Adrienne. Thank you for like bringing us all into your mix. The Strange Famous roster, you've just like bang, bang, bang. And our friends like Eligh. Eligh, my ping pong partner on the Pay Dues tour in 1935. I miss you so much. It meant a lot that we were able to kind of bro down during those trips when people were out doing crazy stuff and we just played ping pong. We had to do our thing. But also, you had a child late in life, similar to me. We're living a very similar situation where, as artists, we have this extra pressure to monetize our art and try to provide for these kids while touring isn't as comfortable or easy as it used to be. And so I'm on social media, but I lurk most of the time. And I lurk your Twitter feed, and I came across the synthesizer you bought your daughter for Christmas. Now, I bought my kids synthesizers like this too. I just want to know, how many days was it before it broke? Because mine broke, our kids broke. It took like 3 days most. You know what didn't break? My wooden bus. I still got it. So what I'm here to ask you is, do you have any tips that you've learned in your fatherhood that you're like, oh, this is a trick, other people should know about this? Because I got some of my own, but I want to learn yours. Peace to y'all. I love you. Strange Famous!
That was so good, dude. Wow. Shout out to Sage, man. Made me so happy. Made me almost tear up, man. Aww. That was quite a memory from that tour, man. 1935. We were like, hey, Shane, let's go play the ping pong, huh? we played ping pong so many damn times. I don't even know how we had access to ping pong tables in so many cities. Maybe it was just a couple. But yeah, man, I love that guy. Tips.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do they call those synthesizers? Or just
that,
like noisy,
that I got,
noisy toys?
No, this one is literally a synthesizer that works. Like it does shit. When you turn the knobs, it changes the sounds and there's filters and da da da. And it's annoying as hell though. Like my wife was like, I hate this present. I hate it. But it's sick though, man. She messes with it and she has not broken it yet. But you know, I think there's something to the fact that boys are a little more aggressive with shit, throwing shit around and throwing themselves around. So maybe there's that. But tips, dude, any kind of secrets that I've learned, man. Oh.
Well, you kind of even said you're the one about, I mean,
not judging other parents. Yeah. Or like,
Absolutely. Oh, yeah. You're right. Unsolicited advice.
Yeah.
Towards other parents. Don't do it. That's what, well, there's one thing I've learned for sure is that, yes, like I said, everyone's situation is different. Everybody's kid is different. Like, you, what works for you is not going to work for them. It's just, and sometimes your specific child is just completely, you know, an enigma from everybody else's children. So, you know, it just because, like, you know, oh, your kid still doesn't sleep through the night. Mine's been sleeping since day one. Well, fucking great for you, motherfucker. Mine is not. And so it's like, yeah, unsolicited advice, stay away from it. That's a big one. That's honestly a big tip that I would give new parents. But he's right. Like, we are in a similar boat as far as having children later in life and in our 40s. And we are very kind of parallel in that sense. And I've known since I was young that I wouldn't have a kid. If I had a kid, it wouldn't be until I was 41, 42. And I called it. I called it my whole life. I was like, it's not going to happen until 40s. I know I wasn't ready till then.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Just was not. And, you know, 40s the new 20, man. Come on, man.
It's true. It really is.
I mean, times have changed for sure. But, you know, if I had a child in my 20s, oh, my God, a poor kid. It just, there's too much work to be done on me.
That you're right. I think that for a lot of people, especially like artist types, and I hate to just generalize it, but I feel like artists are spending a lot of time trying to figure themselves out, and sometimes it's a bad thing to have a child when you're still trying to figure yourself out.
Yeah. That could turn into a lot of trauma. You know what I mean? Stolen trauma that I'm trying to avoid at this point. I'm very aware of what was passed to me. And I'm not trying to transfer that to her and keep the chain going. I'm trying to break that. And that goes along with all the habits and the language and every way that we were raised that I don't want to raise her in that way. And that's why I'm glad I married somebody and have a partner who already had a whole different mode in her head and about how she wanted to raise her. And I'm with her on all of it. I'd never had one argument. It's hard. It's like I said, it's challenging. And especially when you're tired, I kind of like resort to old patterns when I'm tired. So where if I'm, you know, alert and aware, I would definitely not say, no, don't do that. But when I'm tired, I'll just be like, don't.
And yeah.
I'm like, fuck, there I go doing that shit again. So yeah, dude, this was the right time. It was the right time for me.
Yeah. Well, looks like about a couple more minutes on the timer here. Let me hit you with a couple of quick questions, and then we'll let you get out of here. But the whole point of the DOD45 was I just didn't want to take up people's time because I know how important people's time is. So I was intrigued. I always thought it would be intriguing to let them know, like, it's just 45 minutes. It's not like a 5-minute interview, but at least it's only not 45. Yeah, sometimes only if the guest is like keeps going, I do it. But yeah, for the most part, I try to stick pretty close to it. Let me ask you this question. If you were forced to be on Dancing with the Stars, who would you rather have as your dance partner, Tiger Woods or Elijah Wood?
Elijah Wood. Oh my God, I'm embarrassing. Dancing with a Hobbit, dude. Probably Elijah Wood. I don't think Tiger Woods is not a very, he's just a kind of square dude, man. I just imagine he was stepping on my feet and like, fucking, come on, bro. Like, you play golf, but you can't dance. Like, I can't see Tiger Woods being a good dancer. I'm sorry.
That sounded like a good lyric from a song. You play golf, but you can't dance.
Yeah, I think that's just my personal opinion. And his back's fucked up. You know, I don't want to dance.
Oh, that's true. Well, then, and yeah, speaking of The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings, I guess I don't know why I didn't even put it together, but you sometimes have an AKA of Gandalf.
Yeah.
How often do you use that, and what was it? Where did it come from? Because I guess
well, the Hobbit cartoon, 1977 cartoon, it's one of my favorite all time movies, and so I've always been a huge fan of that book, that movie, The Hobbit in particular, not even Lord of the Rings.
Right.
And so on my second album, Story of Two Worlds, I sampled, you know, I sampled some pieces of that record because I think Grouch had a copy of it and I was like, oh, my favorite shit. And I just started sampling it and it just quickly became my producer nickname was Gandalf because like I need to have a separate identity for my producing side. And the only time I use it is honestly when I make instrumental albums still. And I've made like three or four instrumental album projects that I give specifically to people that show up at these trunk sales that I do every once in a while to incentivize people to show up in person and collect this album that you get for free just for showing up. And they're handmade, written on, and I call them Gandalf's beat, trunk machine. Because I started those off, those trunk sales, literally selling merch out of my trunk. I just parked somewhere. Wow. People will show up, give them the address. And now when I do them, it's like a pop-up shop. I do it in a store. And I still call them Gandalf's Trunk Machine. But I do have... I haven't made a Gandalf's Beat Machine album in a long time because I've wanted to be really epic with it. Instead of just putting a bunch of beats in order and putting some samples around it, I really wanted to make sort of scores. Like, yeah. I just released a project that was unexpected.
About is that the one with the tree on
yeah,
it?
Yeah, that one was like a month and a half ago. It wasn't something I planned. It was actually an NFT-related project that a photographer friend who had 12 photos he took in Korea when he went to visit with his mom. He took these beautiful photos. He's a dope photographer. And I ended up putting music to every photo. And I used a bunch of scores that I've made over the years because I've been wanting to score film for a long time and just trying to manifest someone giving me a shot to score a film. Because I always say this, like when somebody lets me in the door, I'm not going to leave. It's on because I want to score a film so badly. I'm like, excited. To
well, you're that, and that album, when I have a guest on, I'll deep dive and I'll put all of their music in one spot. And just for weeks, everything I do is what's playing. But, that album sounds very much like a film score. It's very well done. I really enjoy it. I was trying to think of what movie it played like a. Yeah, I was trying to think of what movie it reminded me of. I was going to say Crouching Tiger, but it doesn't at all. That's because I just the last four nights I've been watching, falling asleep to Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon. But it doesn't matter. But it's really well done. People should check that out. Eli does make some really good music for scores. So yeah, that's good to know.
Somebody, you know, it'll happen when it's supposed to happen, but when it does, I'll be, I'll be excited for sure.
Have you done a lot of your life that way where you manifested stuff that you've thought about for a long time? Because really, like you mentioned, once you get that chance, there are the people who don't do anything with that chance. And they're the people that are like, oh, I'm fucking barreling through this door.
Yeah, I think so. I don't think I was aware of, my tendency or ability or whatever to manifest things that I wanted, but I definitely was doing it without knowing it. You know, I mean, from the gate, like I didn't want to go to school. I wanted to make music. So I dropped out of school. Okay. I don't want to work at Urban Outfitters or the mall or fucking, you know, Time Life selling books to people on the phone. I want to make music. So I never got a job. No one would hire me because I didn't want to be hired. So I just wouldn't accept any other road than I want to make music. And it led me to the Bay. It led me to meeting Grouch and the Journeyman. And then, oh shit, Merce is here and we already knew each other. Oh, and then it just went. And that's all a manifestation and being and allowing the wind to take me where I needed to go. But now I am very aware of the ability to manifest and really just, you know, putting it out there and speaking the language, speaking the words to make it happen. And now the fucking gardener is like, right here. So I think that
well, you got to give yourself some credit. You can't give it all to the wind because that also takes a tremendous amount of work from you.
Absolutely. No.
Yeah, you've been a grinder. And as fans, we're all fortunate and lucky because of your grind and what you put into it. And I personally would like to thank you for making beautiful music for your whole career and your solo stuff, absolutely. And I I love you and Grouch. I love Grouch and Eligh. I just love it. I love it. Love it. Love it so much. So, right before we let you go, I want to get you to, I want to get a few plugs in, but I do want to finish out my Living Legends question.
Yeah.
And so that goes, I hide them in here. So this question is Tom Cruise in Legend or Brad Pitt in Legends of the Fall?
Oh, Tom Cruise in Legend, dude.
Come oh, wow.
Are you kidding? Dude, you understand that I sampled Legend on Sideway Days, my third ever album. There's Legend samples on there. On Sideway Days, there's a sample of the devil, the Tim Curry played devil, talking to... Well, him talking to Father, who is the real devil, about being obsessed with this girl. And then that's the intro to a song.
Father, I hold the world in my grasp. And yet this girl strikes me. It has been an eternity since I felt such desire. What am I?
Oh, you're gonna go back and listen to that.
Yes, definitely Tom Cruise Legend.
All right, well, man, I appreciate you coming and being on the show. It's it really is an honor, and I look forward to seeing what else comes out of you. So, with that, what do you feel is the best way for people to stay connected with you? Where do you like people to get their Eligh fix from? And is there anything else you want to promote?
I spend a lot of time on Twitter because if there's any social media where I feel like I need to be, it's on Twitter because that's where Web3 NFT action is happening. So that's where I spend a lot of time. But patreon.com/Eligh, man. Patreon, I've been doing for 4 years, almost 5 years now. And I've been dropping, exclusive songs and art there every month for almost 5 years. There's like 62 songs that if you're not a part of my Patreon, you've never heard them. And merch drops, and everybody on Patreon gets everything I do first, no matter what it is. And it's a tight knit little community of good vibes and good energy. And I would definitely want people to come join my Patreon. That'd be number one. But if that's not possible, then come hang out with me on Twitter. Just take a look what I'm doing there. That would be probably my number one plug. And your owl is fire, bro.
Well, thank you. I will get it making it look even better for you. I'll add a few colors and more
that
things
shit
in there.
Is dope, dude.
What about when they want to get merch and stuff, the website?
Yeah, eligmusic.com.
Okay.
Absolutely. That's where I would tell you to go. And, I sell my art there and of course all my merch, all my music, albums that aren't even in print anymore. I have all the digital versions there so you can buy albums that haven't been in print for a while. And, in general, eligmusic.com is where you get most everything I do.
Yeah. Awesome. Oh, you know what? I have this one. It's like the real Sophie's Choice question. Let me just hit it with you real quick.
Yeah.
This is a true Sophie's Choice. If only one of these two things could have ever existed in this realm, which would you be willing to have never experienced? LL Cool J's Bad or the movie Beat Street?
Beat Street.
Oh, you'd let Beat Street go and then get the Bad? Yeah. Can you spit? I'm not asking you to do it right now, but can you spit that Bad verse lyric to the end?
You know what? I was listening to it not too long ago, and I realized I memorize patterns. Always memorize melodies and patterns more than words. And sometimes I'm like, I still don't know the words to this all the way. but I do know it pretty well. I would have to, I couldn't just like spit it off the top of my tired ass dad brain, but I do know a lot of lyrics from that song. Because that,
if it's play, if Bad or Colors, if either one of those two songs are playing, I can do it verse all the way. Both songs are so fantastic. Yeah. All right, Eligh, man. Thanks for spending your time with us. We really appreciate it. I'll reach out to you as soon as this episode will air next Wednesday. I'll get your drawing looking nice and tight. I'll get it all buttoned up, and then I'll get it sent out to you. And again, we really appreciate having you on. Thank you so much.
Really appreciate you guys. Thanks for having me. Anytime, man. We could do it again. And
I got a bunch of other questions for you.
No, bro. I'm very impressed you did that in 45 minutes, man. Before I go,
Oh, yeah.
I have my iPad in front of me because I'm working on something. I draw on my iPad a lot. I resisted drawing on an iPad for years. I was like, I'm not drawing digitally. I'm a pencil paper guy. And then I got into NFTs and realized that my art that is like scanned drawings, when you put it next to digital art, it's just like, wow, dude, their shit's blowing my shit out of the water. It just pops so hard.
Sure.
And I finally gave in. I bought an iPad. First drawing I did on it, I was like, and what was it? It was an owl. I was like, this is fucking great. Like,
oh, wow.
I love it, bro. I love it.
Yeah.
So this is a whip work in progress still, but I wanted to show you guys.
Let's see it. Fuck yeah.
Working on.
Oh, wow.
I don't know if you can see
a peacock
it.
In it. Yeah. Yeah, that's really cool.
But it's, dude, like I can blow this up when it's done. I can blow it up as big as this wall.
Yeah, like a 1200 DPI.
Won't be pixelated. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So that's another benefit. Like you draw that owl on your iPad at a big enough DPI and then you could print it out giant. And so that appeals to me. Not only that, but you can use any brush, any paint. You can use paint, markers, every color imaginable is at your fingertips.
Yeah.
So that part is fun, dude. That part is fun.
Well, can I ask you then, do you still go back? Do you still, you know, yeah.
Okay. I have three drawings that I did recently where I was just like, I feel like I'm drawing on paper. Signing them, framing them, putting them to the side. And then eventually they'll make money for the fam, but I'm just stacking them right now. I'll stack a bunch of drawings and frame them and make them look nice. And drawing on paper, nothing will ever replace that. It's a whole different vibe feeling. And it's funny, bro. Like I draw so much on this that I'll be drawing on paper and I'll be like, and I'll try and expand the paper. I'm like, wait, what am I doing, dude? I can't expand the paper, bro.
Well, maybe one of these times we'll have to have you out to our gallery and show some of your work in there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Our gallery's in Missouri, though.
That's true. It is.
So it's a little farther away, but.
It'll be a reason to visit Missouri, that's for sure.
There you go. St. Louis.
Cheers, guys.
All right,
nice
man.
Nice meeting you.
Yeah, it was very nice meeting you. Nice hanging with you. I love your artwork, by the way, too. I kept commenting about your music, but I am a fan of your artwork as well.
Thank you so much, man.
All right, Eli.
Can't wait to see that owl finish, bro.
Word. Cheers. All have a good rest of your day.
Peace, guys.
Peace.
Bye.
This beat feels like holding grandfather's hand in a picture I recall from a scrapbook way back when.
Awesome. See, I'm glad that I got the... What am I trying to say here? Sometimes when it's something that I haven't drawn or something, I think I go a little longer. I think now I'm just realizing it at this very moment, episodes go a little longer when I'm struggling with what I'm drawing. Is that maybe a case?
Did this go long?
No. This is about exactly 45 minutes. Well, the timer didn't buzz.
It didn't go off, but I...
But it was pretty close.
Okay.
But my timer also, I might need to get a new timer.
You have this thing called a phone, and they have
I know, but there's something cool about this old school thing. It's kind of neat, you know? Yeah, I mean, just like, you know, there's a thing about drawing on an iPad that works for him. I'm happy for him.
You know what I love?
What's that?
That my phone has a calculator.
My brain has a calculator.
Yours does. So if I can't get to my phone, I definitely use your calculator.
Yeah, there's some things that I don't want to give up, or not give up, but there's some things that I just love, and my brain calculator is one of them. I like to figure out those numbers, but I understand if you don't like doing that,
if you just can't.
Sure. But that's the same with the drawing on the digital drawing. Cause I know he had said thought he'd never go to that. Mm-hmm. And, I just know I never will. but our careers are different as well.
Yeah, but you might have fun with it. I know that my phone just updated and it was like, there's this thing on it now. It's called, Freeform. And it's like a drawing app that just came.
Yeah. Right, I got a really nice, iPad pen, I think for Christmas. A couple of years ago, I haven't even opened that, but I guess I should give it a try. I don't want to. You know what my fear is? My fear is that I'll end up being yes, and then all of a sudden it changes. Like our friend, or Bird's friend. His artwork, his pen work, and his drawing, I love it. It is so good. It's so, so good. But his digital stuff, also people love that, but I'm not so much into it. And so, but he never, I never see him doing the pen stuff. He enjoys doing the digital so much. So I worry that that would happen to me. Oh, I don't know. Hey, how great was that, right? Yeah. Eli was awesome.
It was really nice.
Yeah, it was. I'm so happy you could be on.
Congratulations on his kid and figuring himself out. And
yeah, it seems like he's got that fatherhood thing and raising or family thing kind of, it's working in his favor.
I was thinking when he was saying unsolicited advice.
You were about to give some advice?
No. But I'm like, oh, well, you do that to your children when they're young because you're teaching them. And then all of a sudden when they turn into teenagers and you're still doing that.
Oh, see.
It turns into unsolicited advice for your teenagers. And they're like, oh, I don't want
wait,
to stop, Mom. Because
I, his unsolicited advice, I felt.
It was towards other parents.
Other giving him
but
advice.
But I'm just saying, as a parent, you do that. And then all of a sudden they're like.
Yeah.
I actually was just telling you something. I don't want to hear what you have to say about it, Mom.
Yeah, our kids are very much in that stage now, huh? They don't want
to. So now I'm keeping my mouth shut as much as I can mode.
I didn't even focus on saying so while I'm editing the episode, I'm gonna go.
You don't have to edit them out.
I don't edit them out. I'm just saying I made a point to not Sam.
Hey, are you ready to get back to Missouri?
I am.
We're going in less than a week. But the next episode will be from this studio, but
our next episode
will
with Fort.
Not from this studio. So yeah. How do you feel about that?
I'm happy about it. But I like the way I got this all set up, but I'll just get the other studio set up. Nice.
I know. This is a better space for this pod.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. I could probably get it set up a little better at the other space.
But I'm ready to leave. I'm out of here.
I'm ready. And are you excited to go to Miami at all or not?
I actually am.
Yeah.
And I was not looking forward to it. I was really upset that we were doing it at all, but
I'm
ready to get out of here.
Yeah, it's cold. Also, I'm really bummed. They're playing at the Urban Lounge.
Know,
so I'm
too bad.
Yeah, I saw that when they were coming through.
Well, they'll come again.
Yeah, and maybe they'll be doing something out St. Louis way. Yeah, I'm a fan. I've been a long time.
I know. I keep looking at all these artists. I wasn't joking. I was thinking this the other day. All these artists are now coming out with their tours, and I'm looking, trying to figure out where are we going to be? Can we catch the show?
Yeah.
And I really think this is going to be their year. They're selling, the concerts I'm seeing are selling out quick. Yeah. So,
well, you sent me a text last night when I was out here working on some new pieces. I didn't see that until late last night, but to Primus.
No, it's Les
Claypool's Frog Brigade.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there's this other show that was coming to St. Louis that I was looking up, and it's called, oh crap, Australians Do Pink Floyd or something.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But we won't be there for that. But it looked really cool. And they do. This one was going to be the whole Wall album. And that's the whole thing.
Yeah, I'm good to go
really
to
cool.
any
I know,
shows.
But
they're so much fun.
We don't. This year is the roller coaster year.
Well,
so
that's okay. The way you stay on. Every once in a while, you got to get off of the roller coaster. Hey, I was going to say one thing. Huh?
What?
I don't know. Sometimes you got to get off the roller coaster and go to a show.
No, but I don't know if we're going to be in Missouri or in Utah.
I know. I did want to say to people why it's important to go and comment on the episodes or even let us know how you feel about this show. I used to produce a TV show in Salt Lake City called 3.2%, and it was a show where we went around and highlighted all the great things. The concept was 96.8% of the things in Utah are exactly what you think Utah is. 3.2% of Utah is fantastic. And so that was what the show was. Anyway, when the show was airing, it aired every Sunday. Was it Sunday night, Adrienne?
I think so.
Yeah, it was on Sunday nights. I was grinding my ass off doing this show. It's pretty much a one-man show. I did have a partner, a TV producing partner, but it was basically just me grinding, nonstop grinding, doing this TV show. I was filming it, doing the segment producer, editor, all. Anyway, the whole time, I had no idea if anyone was watching it. I just was just doing it. And so when it came to it, there was a point after the first season where there were some things coming down to it, and I had some things that happened, and I walked away from the show because I was like, I don't even know if anyone's watching this. So I just walked away. I did actually make it easier to walk away from the show when we had some big things coming up for the second season. Anyway, several months later, we were reading the newspaper. We were at dinner, and we were several months later after I had quit the show. We were reading the newspaper, and we had won like a Best of Utah award, and it was our TV show. And in the article, it was talking about how people loved the show, and they had no idea why did the show end, blah, 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 blah. Well, it ended because no one was telling us. Well, and this was also pre-internet. But
pre-telephone, pre-cell phone, pre-internet, a lot of things,
yeah,
because we have the internet,
but we have no idea. Well, I do. I see the numbers on our on Spotify and Apple, and I'm happy.
And what
with
you
those.
Just want people to comment, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, comment. I went the long, that was a long route of like, if you enjoy the show, let us know, because it does make it, it's nice to at least know that people are enjoying the show. What'd you feel about the before we go, what'd you feel about the Sage Francis? The Sage's social media lurk. It was fun, right? Mm-hmm. It was cool. That's nice. I don't know how...
I think his eyes are green.
Oh, shoot. I was going to ask Eli what color his eyes were before I colored in these eyes.
Eyes are sage green.
Sage's?
I wonder if his mom did that on purpose.
Hmm.
But maybe they're not. Maybe they just look green.
I didn't... yeah, so as you notice, I dropped a couple of questions. I dropped some things. Okay, well... Do you want a question? Let me ask you a question.
Ask me. Ask away. I probably won't have the answer, but...
If you could have an unlimited supply of one thing for the rest of your life, what would you pick?
Unlimited supply of one thing?
Yeah.
Probably clean water.
Wow.
Because then you can grow things, you can take baths, you can drink...
I just want all of the money in the world, and then someone can grow it for you. Just kidding. Yeah, that's interesting. Clean water. We don't have... Oh, unlimited. Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you never know.
That's true. No, that's true. Good answer. You're sophisticated.
I don't... You know what I really... I wish... You know what I really don't want is that brain-eating amoeba. Do you know how much I like jumping in lakes?
Oh, yeah. Well, don't do that anymore.
That's what I'm going to probably die from.
Oh, that would be lame.
Let's get the amoebas out of our water.
Well, let's get out of here. Okay. That was really great. Thanks, Eli, for joining us. Hopefully, we'll be able to get Grouch in here.
They should have come on together. Maybe next time they can come on together.
You know what I realized, though? The two guests at once is hard. For me because I'm looking at the drawing, and I can't see, like, if someone was getting ready to say something, and so I end up cutting them off. You know what I mean?
All right.
But if anyone made a perfect couple to, like, come on as two, a twosome, mm-hmm. a duo, it would be those two. But maybe we can do that next time. That's what we did with AWOL 1. You know, we first just had AWOL, and then we did AWOL and Gelrock.
Slugging and Dibs.
Yeah, Slug and Dibs. Yeah, that was our first twofer. But that made each other better.
Okay.
Okay. Well, thanks, everyone, for joining us at DOD45W, at ArtByTai, on all the socials. DOD45 is now on Facebook, just at DOD45, because I see that people will still hang out at Facebook. Probably never going to be on Twitter again. And ArtByTai.com, DOD45.com. Our next guest will be Thortz. And thank you to Strange Famous Records. Boy, I was really hoping that we could see what Dibs had come up with for Eli. Oh, well.
Next time.
Next time. There will be a next time. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Have a great rest of your week. Have a great rest of your life. Peace.
D-O-D-45.
Thank you for joining in on yet another episode of DOD45. Please hit the subscribe or follow button so that you never miss an episode. You can even go one step further by leaving us a review on Apple Podcasts to help other interesting people like yourself find our podcast.
You can find me at ArtByTai on all the socials or at ArtByTai.com. If you'd like to follow this podcast on social media, we are at DOD45W on Instagram, or you can go over to our website, DOD45.com, where you can shoot us an email, join our mailing list, and watch all of our past episodes. Thanks for joining us. Peace.